The body of a man is found buried in the snow high on a remote mountain range. But this is no accident. He's been murdered. And he turns out to be the ultimate cold case for investigators. The corpse of Ötzi the Iceman is over 5,000 years old. Steve Pennells looks at the incredible forensic work in solving this mystery, including getting to hear Ötzi talk.
The reasons why people kill each other are still, in a way, the same. You've got jealousy, you've got revenge. It's about sexuality, it's about power, it's about beliefs. Those are the usual motives we have.
On the top of this glacier, a brutal murder has taken place.
So around here, you reckon, is where the body was found?
Yes, actually. Whereas around here, just in that place down here.
One of Europe's best detectives, Chief Inspector Alex Horn, has brought me to the spot.
So he would have been facing this way.
Yeah.
And his attacker were possibly behind those rocks.
Over there.
So you think it's down?
It's his first time here, and he's looking for clues.
He would have seen anyone following him, you would think.
But I think he was probably not aware that he was followed.
He has a body and a crime scene, but no witnesses. And there's just one other small problem. He's 5,300 years too late. And this is the victim, a body found frozen in ice on the border of Italy and Austria. Police first thought he was a hiker who had fallen to his death. But he didn't match any missing persons reports, and no one came forward to police.
The first thought were this was somebody climbing in the mountains and had an accident, and he was covered by snow.
He was, in the beginning, treated as an unknown dead person. The forensic expert said, we haven't found any documents, we haven't found a ring on his hand, so we cannot tell anything about him. The usual procedure would be after a certain time to just bury him and to cremate him.
It turned out that the body wasn't just far older than anyone thought. It was one of the most perfectly preserved mummies ever found. A frozen flesh and bone time capsule of the Copper Age, 5,300 years ago. His cremation was cancelled and an industry was formed. They called him Ötzi.
In the world of mummies, he's a bit of a rock star, isn't he?
I would say so. I think he's maybe number one.
And this is what archaeologists believe he looked like. The clothes are a recreation of what he wore when he was found.
He was quite small compared to our population. He was maybe just 160 or 5 foot 2 inches. He had brown hair, he had brown eyes. He was a very active person. I think he would not look so much different from people today.
For 25 years, Ötzi has been on display here in the city of Balzano in North Italy. His body and possessions offering up clues to what life was like 53 centuries ago. But there were still things that had scientists baffled. A wound in his left shoulder from an arrow which was never found, and stab marks on his right hand, signs of extreme violence. One thing was becoming increasingly clear. Ötzi's death was no accident. And so began the coldest of cold cases.
I was wondering, you know, why would the director of the Iceman Museum call me? And she said, so what's the coldest case that you worked on, or the oldest case that you worked on? I said, like, I think about 40 years or something like that. And then she said, well, mine is a little bit older.
To solve one of the world's oldest murder mysteries, they turned to one of Europe's most renowned detectives, Chief Inspector Alex Horn.
Ötzi was preserved in such a good way in the ice that actually he's in a better condition than some of the murder cases that I was working on, more recent ones. And so therefore we decided we're gonna give it a try.
This is the place where the arrow shot hit.
A crack team was assembled and a case file was opened. Alex Horn recruited forensic pathologist Oliver Peschel, a man who had worked alongside him in previous murder cases.
When the arrowhead hits the body through the shoulder blade.
And for a more ancient perspective, mummy expert Albert Zink.
We were looking for some help from experts who are, let's say, regularly dealing with murder cases and forensic cases.
There was no forensic pathologist, but Ötzi is a forensic case. He's the victim of a homicide.
We had a lot of good evidence. Injuries-wise, I would categorize it down into three distinctive injuries that were of major concern to us. Number one was the injury from the arrow which hit him and went into his right shoulder and all the way in, which caused actually the fatal wound. There was some blunt force to the head. And there was one specific wound that I was interested in. There was a deep cut in the right hand. This is why we call it a defense wound. This means you are actually grabbing into like a knife or a sharp object. So he was obviously grabbing into something in defending himself.
So someone was attacking him?
Someone was attacking him.
He was trying to protect himself, but also possibly disarm the attacker.
Yes.
Forensic tests showed that this defense wound on his hand happened about 2 days before Ötzi was murdered. A breakthrough in the case.
So you think he was attacked or in a fight 1 or 2 days before he was killed?
Yes, sir. And I think this is pretty solid information. Probably he was in a fight and he won that fight. I think it's not a coincidence that you have a fresh injury, classic defense wound injury, and you've got a murder the next day.
Injured, and maybe fearing his attackers would come back to finish the job, Ötzi fled, making the treacherous journey up the glacier that separates modern-day Italy and Austria. Somewhere he thought he'd be safe. But he was being hunted. If Ötzi was running for his life, it didn't work. 48 hours after he survived the first attack, the second would be fatal.
So I'm Ötzi.
Yeah.
I'm having a rest here.
Yeah.
Sitting, maybe facing this way.
Yeah.
Where would my killer be?
Well, actually, probably somewhere from behind there. So that the shot, it came and it hit like there, which had enough energy to get you down on the ground. It was really massively injuring your arm, which you could use then, not anymore. So you fall down, actually, and you stay like that.
So Ötzi's hit on the back here by someone possibly over there, falls down at this spot, and stays there for 5,500 years almost.
That's it. I mean, the way he was falling down, probably the offender turned him around or something like that. But I mean, this is a spot to die. Nobody's going to be around.
It's a pretty lonely place to die.
It is.
In your opinion, this was cold-blooded murder?
I think so, yeah. Especially if you consider that, you know, this was not from a face-to-face. This was when he was turning his back on the back. This is why we wouldn't call it manslaughter, we would call it murder.
We leave with a better idea of what happened up here, but we still don't know why. Back in the Copper Age, this region was densely populated. Humans had just discovered metal extraction and settled here because of the region's rich mineral deposits. Trade links were forged and communities emerged. Very little else is known about what life was like in Ötzi's time. But his body is giving answers. The food in his stomach, dried meat and grains, tells us what he ate. Minerals in his bones and teeth show us Ötzi grew up north of the Alps, but moved south in his final months. The pollen in his gut reveals he died in late spring. And it also shows, with incredible accuracy, his final movements. Nature's GPS.
We knew from also this intestinal analysis of the pollen, of the stomach content and intestinal content, that he actually walked in the last 36 hours of his life. He walked up to 2,500 meters, walked down again and walked up again.
And the answers Ötzi's revealing aren't just about the past. He suffered from diseases that, until now, doctors believed were modern ailments. This ancient man has turned medicine on its head.
Well, he had quite a lot of diseases. He had, for example, intestinal parasites, from time to time problems with his digestion and caused problems. He had already problems with his heart, with his arteries. He also had degenerative diseases like in the spine, for example, in his knee joints, in his ankle joints. And in the end, he also had a very problem with his stomach. It's fascinating because it turns out that he's a human like we are, so he's very close to us. And we very much hope that we, by analyzing these diseases in an ancient patient, we can learn something also for our medicine and for our clinical studies and to help our patients, our modern patients, to get rid of these diseases or to prevent also these diseases.
So it could lead to some medical breakthroughs.
Absolutely.
We're finding out more and more about Ötzi. We know he lived in a house like this. We know what he ate. We know all about his health problems. We know he walked through this valley before he was killed on that mountain. But the big question still remains. What happened down here that got him murdered up there?
It is the coldest of cold cases. A man hunted and murdered on a lonely mountaintop. His body lying untouched for 5,300 years.
If you could ask Ötzi one question, what would it be?
Why did he kill you? I think why did he kill you would be the most interesting question, yes. The motivation.
Most of the murder cases we have, it's the basic principles. It's about human behaviors. It's about emotions. The human being is an emotional being, and therefore it's about themes like revenge, jealousy, envy. It's those kind of strong emotions will bring you to the point to cross a border of doing things that you would normally not do.
Or the classic motive, could a woman be involved?
Well, yeah, that's always an option. And jealousy is a strong emotion.
He just might have slept with the wrong man's wife.
That is always a reason to kill somebody.
If only Ötzi could talk. This is about as close as we're going to get. Here in Bolzano, a team of doctors has achieved something truly remarkable. Using CT scans, they've managed to recreate Ötzi's vocal cords and simulate his speech.
Can we hear Ötzi?
Sure. This is an introduction for you.
Hello, my name is Ötzi. It's very nice to meet you.
Hello, my name is Ötzi.
It's very nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you too, Ötzi.
I don't know Australian English, but...
It's very good, that's amazing. You've managed to make a man who's been dead for more than 5,000 years have a voice.
We'll probably never know what language Ötzi spoke. But after all this time, modern technology is bringing this mummy to life.
If you could ask Ötzi one question, what would it be?
I would ask what is your name, actually, because we have no idea. We always call him Ötzi or Iceman or Frozen Fritz, as it's sometimes called. It would be very interesting to know actually his real name, what his name was. So this would be, I think, my first question.
Do you feel you've got a connection?
Yeah, somehow, yes. So I always try also to communicate with him and to also understand him as a person. There are these moments sometimes when you maybe did some analysis and you're alone with him, and you're also then a bit grateful to him to say, thank you that you let do all the things with you, that you're so patient with us and allowing us doing all these fascinating things with him.
You thank him?
Yeah, I thank him actually. I'm grateful to him.
Why is it important to know how Ötzi died? Because it's a murder. And it is a murder, so we always have to ask, why did it happen? I think this is important.
But it was a murder 5,300 years ago.
I know, still it is a murder. And somebody's responsible for that. We will not get him, but still we need to think about what has happened. This is what makes murder investigation so important, because, you know, every life counts. And there was a life that was taken with violence.
Isn't that fascinating? And you can visit Ötzi the Iceman. He's on permanent display in that museum in northern Italy.